The next item of business is consideration of business motion 10339 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to this week's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 10339 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. And at question number one, I call Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what percentage of short-term let operators have applied to be licensed in advance of the deadline for applications under the licensing scheme of 1st of October.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Over the last decade, the short-term let sector has grown significantly and changed in nature, which has brought economic benefits but also raised concerns about consistency of quality and the impact on local communities. Following two public consultations and independent research, this Parliament passed licensing legislation in January 2022. All existing hosts will need to have their application in before 1st of October to continue trading, having had 20 months to apply. According to local councils' public registers, as of 31st August, 6,323 applications have been received, and just over half of those have been issued with a licence, with none refused. Over the next few days, I will be writing to all MSPs on how they can encourage and support all operators to submit an application.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. Today, operators of self-catering properties are rallying outside this Parliament to highlight concerns they have about the unintended consequences of this legislation. The Association of Scottish Self-Caterers estimate that nearly two-thirds of those currently operating could actually give up their businesses as a result, which would have a devastating impact on our tourist sector. So what assessment has the Scottish Government done of the financial cost and the jobs that will be lost as a result of this policy?
Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. In terms of that, I mean, I have been negotiating and working with the sector over a period of months. In fact, on my first day in the role, I met with the Association of Scotland Self-Caterers, and I met them three times then since March. I've also spoke to the SOLAR, which is the licensing bodies for local authorities, in terms of that. Now, costs do vary in terms of depending on the size of the building and depending on what they need to do. So the BREA, for example, looked in terms of costs averaging around about £250 to £450. As I said, that varies depending on the size of the application and then the details around about that required.
Murdo Fraser.
Well, thank you. But there was no answer there about the number of jobs that might be lost or the cost to the economy. And this legislation doesn't affect just standalone self-catering units in city centres. It affects traditional bed and breakfasts, guest houses, home shares, house swaps and farm cottages, many of which have been operating successfully for years, providing excellent service to visitors with no negative issues, and yet now face substantial additional bureaucracy and cost. In a few minutes, we're going to hear from the First Minister apparently telling us how he wants a better relationship with business. If this policy isn't now delayed to allow a proper review of the economic impact on our vital tourist sector, won't the First Minister's words just be exposed as no more than empty rhetoric?
Yeah. Minister.
This government listened to the sector. That's why there was a six-month delay about that. And any legislation that comes through is always around about a balance, and licensing is always about safeguarding the quality and consistency of the sector. There were three public consultations before the Scottish Parliament passed legislation in January 2022. As I said, that has brought economic benefits in terms of, but it's also raised concerns, as I said, the consultation about the consistency of quality and the impact on neighbourhoods, which this scheme is addressing.
Thank you, and I call Colin Beattie.
Presiding Officer, would the Minister agree that 22 months' notice, 6 months of which was a very well publicised extension at the request of operators, is more than enough time to have prepared and submitted an application, especially for the majority of short-term let hosts who already abide by high standards, and that the opposition should be encouraging operators to apply in that time that remains, rather than claiming that legislation passed by this Parliament in January 2022 is being implemented too quickly?
Minister.
I agree with what the member has rightly pointed out, that operators have now had just under 2 years to ensure that they comply with licensing conditions. most of which I stress they should already be doing under existing legislation, and a year to prepare and submit their applications. The fact is that no one to date has been refused a licence. From among the thousands that have already applied, I've spoken to businesses and councils, and I'm hearing different messages from those shared here today, that it was straightforward to apply and obtain a licence and that the councils are working with applicants where information is incomplete. The responsible and balanced course of action, of course, is for everyone to get behind the task of encouraging and supporting existing short-term light operators to apply for a licence before the 1st of October deadline. And the key thing is they have to apply before the 1st of October. They have 12, the local authority then has 12 months to look at that and give them their licence beyond that. So licence applications have to be granted by licence authorities unless there are good reasons to refuse them.
Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. As a Highland and Island MSP, I know the benefits the holiday industry can bring to often fragile rural economies, but I also see the negative impact of poorly managed high turnover properties on many of the same communities. Can the Minister say more about how regulation will offer reassurance to communities facing these negative impacts?
Minister.
Thank the member for her question. This summer I undertook a summer tour going around lots of local authorities, and that question was raised. Now, I know from exchanges we've had in recent years across all parties that members have heard from constituents negatively affected by the significant growth of short-term lets, worried about inconsistency of quality and impact on local communities. Independent research undertaken in 2019 identified these impacts in more detail, and we acted on after public consultation to regulate short-term lets to address this. Licensing offers reassurance providing protection and benefits for all businesses, guests, neighbours and communities all across Scotland. It puts in place a formal framework with conditions that responsible businesses should already be functioning within.
Louis Rennie.
The Minister knows that I favour sensible controls and regulation. That's why I favour the control areas. But he needs to listen to the strength of the opposition to the licensing arrangements. This is really strong. At a time of great economic strain, these regulations, I think, are heavy-handed, and there's also been the subject of mission creep. Why doesn't the Minister understand the strength of feeling and reflect on that?
Minister.
Yeah, I have, and I said, on the first day that I engaged in the role, I was in the role, I engaged with the sector straight off. I've met with them twice since then. I've met numerous local authorities talking about that, the licensing schemes. This is coming straight from Solar, the licensing scheme themselves, who think it's a proportionate response to what came through in public consultation in 2019. We'll continue to listen to stakeholders going forward, but this is a proportionate response to what came through in the 2019 consultation.
Thank you. We move on to question two, and I call Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, how many public buildings are currently at risk due to the exposure of reinforced autoclave aerated concrete?
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Survey work is underway across the public sector. Where the presence of RAAC is confirmed in a public building, we expect the owner to take appropriate measures to manage any risk identified. We expect risk assessment of buildings with a confirmed RAAC presence and recommendations for mitigation to follow the current guidance published by the Institution of Structural Engineers. Returns from councils do confirm some presence in 37 schools. Councils have reassured ministers that in the small number of schools where RAAC is present, appropriate mitigation plans are in place.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for that response, and I must thank the Liberal Democratic Party for their FOIs that raised this issue as early as May this year. But it has been something that the government, both north and south of the border, have apparently been aware of for a number of years. So can the Scottish Government confirm that when they are aware of the list of public buildings that are at risk, they will publish that list, keep it updated, and also ensure what steps have been taken to make sure the building is still safe to open?
Cabinet Secretary.
This has, of course, been an issue that the government has been aware of for some time, and that's why action is being undertaken and has been for some time. For example, way back in July 22, Scottish Government officials made contact with the Scottish Heads of Property Services, for example, and Directors of Education in Scotland to share information on RAAC. So that work has been ongoing for some time. I can completely appreciate why there is a public concern on this, particularly given the way that announcements have been handled down in England. But can I reassure the member that we appreciate that public concern means we need to be as open as possible as we can be for this, because parents and staff are concerned about this issue. It is for councils, I think, of course, to publish that information on schools alongside communication with parents and staff, because it's important that we reassure them, both at a national and a local level, about the mitigations that are already being taken place. So I do confirm...
Thank you. We will now move on to Martin Whitfield. Thank you.
I'm grateful for the confirmation that list will be published. Indeed, will what follow from that support for our local authorities with regards to the money that is required, first to ensure that the surveys are taken properly, that the mitigation measures are correct and appropriate, and indeed that they are supported, particularly for some buildings, I'm thinking of particularly some schools that have lost out because of the lack of publication of the Learning Estate Investment Programme?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I mentioned, it is for local authorities to publish that information on schools, and they should do so to ensure that parents and staff are reassured. Can I again reassure the member that both myself and Jenny Gilruth, the Education Secretary, are in regular contact with COSLA to ensure that we are offering support where that is needed and ensuring that we are sharing good practice and information and reaffirming the importance of looking at that professional advice that came from the Institution of Structural Engineers. And we will, of course, keep up that contact, that very close contact with local authorities as this situation developed.
I call Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recognising that any repairs will result in additional spending commitments for the responsible bodies, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what discussion has been had with the UK Government on capital funding to remediate where the material is found in buildings?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, in her letter of the 3rd of September, the Cabinet Secretary for Education asked the UK Secretary of State for Education to clarify the public commitment made by the Chancellor to spend what it takes to make schools safe. That statement was welcomed and early details of the financial support package, which would then follow to devolved governments, is sought. This follows an earlier letter on the 16th of August from the Deputy First Minister to HM Treasury regarding further financial support to help to deal with the consequences of RAC, to which we have yet to receive a reply. It is essential that we do receive early clarity on this matter.
Craig Hoy.
Officer, in Preston Lodge and Preston Pans, 20 classrooms are closed and S1 pupils are being taught off campus. East Lothian Council has already spent over £300,000 to maintain education standards, a sum which is not budgeted for at a time of extreme financial pressure for the Council. Will the Cabinet Secretary therefore commit to reimbursing councils and health boards which have incurred significant non-construction and inspection related costs due to the discovery of RAC?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I refer the member to the answer that I've just given? This is clearly an issue that is affecting administrations right across the United Kingdom, and it is important that the UK Government and the Chancellor take cognizance of that. We are working at a time where we are already having cuts made to our capital budgets. That is making it difficult across government to fulfil the obligations we already have. Of course, we are committed to working with local authorities, but there is, quite frankly, Presiding Officer, an obligation on the UK Government to also step up and ensure that everybody is supported on this issue.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's now been months since I first brought this issue to the attention of the very top of the Scottish Government, and there is still no central register of affected buildings, no strategy for the swift and wholesale replacement of this potentially deadly concrete, and no national fund for cash-strapped schools, health boards and others landed with it. Mitigation and monitoring offers little reassurance when a concrete beam that was marked as safe collapsed, prompting the closure of schools across England. So can the Cabinet Secretary say with confidence today that pupils, patients and staff don't have RAC in the ceilings above them? And is it possible that there are classrooms and wards with this problem concrete still in use right now?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, with the greatest respect to Mr Cole-Hamilton, he did not bring this to the eyes of the Scottish Government. We are already well aware of it for some time and have already had plans in place. That's why there are discovery methods already in place right across government and the public sector on this issue. And can I urge him to have some caution about what he's advising here? Can I urge him, please, to respect the advice of the Institute of Structural Engineers, which has not changed over the past week, despite what's been happening in England. Let's listen to that professional advice. Let's pay close attention, of course, if that does change, but it has not. And let's ensure that we listen to the professionals, we listen to the experts. We, of course, take action where it's needed, and that's exactly why mitigation measures are already in place, where RAC has been identified and those mitigation measures have been required.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. In December 2021, the Government told Parliament it would publish in 2022 the schools that would form Phase 3 of the Learning Estate Investment Programme. They failed to do so. In May and then in June, the Education Secretary said there would be an announcement by the summer recess, but failed to deliver that announcement. So could the Cabinet Secretary tell us how many schools like Dumfries Academy are at risk due to RAC, where the refurbishment or the rebuild is being held up because of the failure of the Government to announce the funding they promised they would announce months ago?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think there are two, with great respect, there's two different issues here, Presiding Officer. Yes, we are, of course, working very closely with the councils where RAC has been identified, I've said in my previous answers. When it comes to the announcement of LEAP Phase 3, I would hope that everyone across the chamber recognises the very difficult circumstances for all capital projects at the moment, particularly because of increasing capital costs, increasing construction costs, and the implications that has. Now, I think it's quite right at that time that government does take longer than perhaps people would like to us to ensure that we're getting the maximum out of that project, and looking at that very seriously. And of course the Cabinet Secretary for Education will make an announcement on that in due course when we are ready to do so.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.